What do you got in your hands there?
Many different forms of native plants that are beneficial in some way or another to the wildlife.
I know what that is.
Yeah, of course you do.
Y'all know a thing or two about that.
And everybody's like, what? How is that beneficial? But the amount of insects that the milkweed can attract can feed turkeys, as well as provide a little bit of cover for a young turkey poult. So that's really the big benefit there. Sometimes I'm sure you guys, when you're picking it, can see it just loaded up with different types of bugs.
Yeah.
So that's one that is commonly scattered across this landscape, and probably become more common as we start burning more. So you'll probably see it more regularly. The next one is beggar's lice, as most people know it. You probably have picked many of those off your pants.
Little triangle stickies.
Incredibly beneficial from a forage standpoint to deer. It attracts insects, it's a forb. So, and then we have the seed pods for wintertime forage. Then of course, goldenrod, attracting a lot of insects, pretty good structure. You see it a lot in old fields or CRP areas. And then this is personally one of my favorites. Matt's got some seeds there in his hand that you guys can see, but this is called Illinois bundleflower. It usually follows disturbance. You can find it in a lot of road ditches. Puts a pretty little bloom, attracts a lot of insects. So that's turkey food with the insects, as well as forage during the winter months with that seed.
And the other thing that...
legume, just like soybeans. So it's just a small soybean pod that you didn't have to pay for.
This would be more beneficial as well if there was not so much grass component and rank grass underneath of this. This is a nice, like, if you will, think of like an umbrella. Well, that protects turkey poults or quail chicks when they're young, right? They can get up underneath.
Yeah.
But they can't do that when there's grass. So this is great to see that it's a component of this field. There's a seed bed there. But this will be more useful after this is burned.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
The major problem, it looks like, that we got here is this.
Yeah.
In this CRP.
Which is extremely common. I mean, this is something we see all the time.
This is something that, I mean, you can list out why are the turkeys declining, and everybody's got an answer, and everybody's right in some capacity. But ultimately, the landscape is changing. It's not only changing from a habitat and plant community list, but it's also changing because it's more conducive in a lot of the aspects to predators like raccoons.
Oh, we've got more bobcats on that camera up there and raccoons than I've ever seen. And we've ran that camera up there in that food plot every year in the same spot all year for 15 years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And just in the last 5-6 years, we have consistently gotten more and more pictures of predators.
We'll probably see rats, moles, rabbits, and everything darting out of this once this is burned.
Yep.
But that thatch load is also holding them too, which is then attracting predators. So by incorporating fire into this on a routine method, you know, every 3-4 years, you might see some of that reduced. When do you think was the last time that was burned? How many years?
10 years ago.
Probably
10 years ago.
There's a heavy fuel.
10 years ago? When we did that.
10 years ago was the last time it burned?
Yeah, I think it's been close to 10
years. That would be one of your largest reasons why the turkeys are gone.
Sure.
Is because it's just too grown up. Like, your woods are starting to grow up with buckbrush and understory things that aren't as beneficial as some of the other ones we've talked about. And then your open areas are incredibly grown up.
Which is why you see a decrease in turkeys, but yet an increase in the deer activity.
Sure, makes sense. And there's good species out there.
Absolutely.
They just have to be freed. And you guys can see it. This is what we're talking about.
Yeah.
I mean, it makes perfect sense after these guys explain it. Quail and turkeys and stuff can't get through that. And that's everywhere, like you said. But you also mentioned not only burning, but spraying that at some point, right?
Yes.
Burning is not going to kill fescue or smooth brome.
Okay,
it has to have herbicide.
Suppressing it during that year, but it's not removing it. So a herbicide application,
killing it at its root system, have to. That's going to be your long-term benefit.
Yeah, for sure. And you know, we can have the debate, herbicide, no herbicide, but ultimately we know that these non-natives aren't benefiting the wildlife like we want them to. So we could try to suppress it with fire, but it's always going to be here. It's just trying to push it back. I just want to get rid of it. And that's where a herbicide treatment, usually one time or two times.
When do you do that?
When it's green, you can do it depending on the herbicide you use. You could do a dormant, when most of the native species are dormant, do kind of a March or April application of glyphosate when this is really green. Or you can wait and burn it and then hit it with a grass-specific herbicide to kill that. And most of the natives are still dormant because it's the soil temperature is so low that it hadn't started growing
so
yet.
You could do that now, you're saying?
When this greens up. So another month, you could probably spray the glyphosate on the fescue and smooth brome and get rid of it.
I see.
Yeah.
And glyphosate is just killing that, or is it killing everything?
At that window.
Yes. Yeah. It's a broad-spectrum herbicide. It's important to note that if there's something green and you spray it with glyphosate, it's going to kill
it. It's going to die. Right.
But that will be the only thing really green out here at that phase of the growing season.
So you have to be very strategic about when you do this.
Yes.
And is there any resources out there for people where they can either learn to do it or they can pay somebody to do it?
Yeah, for sure. Learning it and, you know.
Our podcast.
shameless plug. Another University of Tennessee, Dr. Craig Harper, talks a lot about this.
Great resource.
And he's got great research with it. So, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But with this being in CRP, that's okay to do. I guess I need to be more.
Well, and that's
CRP
one thing.
Probably, but.
Yeah, we want to make sure that this was not a component of planting. If not, then removing this is not an issue.
Yeah,
I see.
And even if it is, let me talk to him.
Yeah, please.
We know the research now that this is not benefiting our wildlife, so we can certainly need to remove it. And there's plenty of other. All those species I picked up, those are here. So all we have to do is get rid of this and we'll have more of those beneficial species.
Short-term quick fix then is burning and that stuff that you've got to keep up on over time. But if you want more of a long-term fix, you need to burn and then spray this.
Yeah.
Or spray ahead of it, then follow up once this is killed and this is dead and thatch, you can burn it then too.
Another thing we may talk about is, if we're able to burn today or tomorrow, great. But then we come back like in March, and it's like, okay, we've got one burn unit. Now this is green. Spray it in early March and then roll in 2 weeks later once this has gotten to the roots and killed the roots. Then we burn that. So we've got something that was burned in February, then something that was burned in March.
Okay.
So we get the best of both worlds. Or even early April when you burn.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be ideal.
Yeah.
Because then it's just sit back and wait for the time.
We got 2 weeks till turkey season then. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's definitely ideal.
Yeah,
there's different ways to attack it based on what your site is, based on your growing season. But regardless, herbicide and application is going to be the long-term fix for this, and then incorporating burning into that.
In this field we're looking at here is, 12 acres, something like that, 10 or 12. Maybe it's bigger than that. I mean, there's different sections.
That bell gets me every time.
Yeah, I thought it was a deer running through there. But I mean, what are you using? Are you using a four-wheeler sprayer to do that?
Yeah, a four-wheeler sprayer. That is a perfect unit. Yeah. Throw a sprayer in the back of it, a little boomless nozzle, so it's like a four-foot thing. It's spraying a 30-foot swath.
60-gallon tank. You can cover 6 acres with that one tank, one fill-up. That's half this field.
Got you.
One application, fire, you're off to the races on changing the plant communities, the dynamics of this and who it benefits and offers value to down the road.
If you haven't burned this in 10 years, that's like the biggest blinking red light. Now we have a problem in where your turkeys have gone.
Yeah.
The place has gotten too grown up.
Yeah, and we've already, as you can see, we've already got the fire breaks kind of prepared. We've got like a fire break through the middle of it, just a mowed path. I don't know if it'll jump that or not because it ain't very wide.
No.
But then you've got this section of the field there, which maybe 30% of the field, and then you have another 30% and another 40% or whatever on this.
Sure.
Yep.
But so you would only burn, say, one right now, and then you'd burn another one.
Ideally, you guys burn, if we have
three sections,
so one of these gets burned every year, and then you may have three sections in the timber, so one of those gets burned every year.
Gotcha.
Then you may have three sections over in the other CRP field. So you burn in one of these sections every year, three different units. And then you just stagger that out in almost a checkerboard effect. And now we've got brood rearing where it's burned and nesting right where it was burned last year or nesting where it was, and then that's more beneficial to deer. The brood rearing areas we just burned are better summer forage for the deer, so they've got more food. So
yeah. I'm definitely gonna need to.
We'll get you lined out. It's hard to take it to memory.
I'm gonna forget it.
We'll get you lined out. But.